Hey guys, welcome to my next session in Java. So in this session, we are going to learn about control statements. So this will be my channel. So you can subscribe to my channel for more updates and further such tutorials in Java. So the agenda for today is Java control statements. So we will look into what are the different control statements in Java, and this will be purely a practical session because I wish and I do strongly feel that everyone needs to practice rather than it, you know, just being theoretical thing. So let's quickly get on to the practical session in Java. So we will be looking into what is if condition, what is if, else if, else condition, what is for loop, while loop, do while loop, switch statement, break and continue. That's all going to be a part of today's agenda. So let's get on into Eclipse. So I've created a new Java file here so that it will be good for a demonstration purpose and I can explain each thing as it is, how to go about. So in Java, there is a syntax to create an object. And the syntax is that you need to mention your class name, give a variable. So this variable is going to be called as your reference variable. And then you will be using new operator to allocate some memory space. And so that whatever value you wish to access or store through this object variable, you could store it in this memory location. Likewise, I have another reference variable created for the same class called obj1. Now let's take a simple demo. If I'm going to use a if condition, so let's say I've created a method here called getComparison. So it has two variables, int a1 and int b1. And I've put here some documentation comments. So this is going to be very important, guys, that for any particular code which you would be writing as a part of your project or any such practical sessions you would be doing on your own, it's always a good practice to put some documentation comment and mention who is the author, when it was created, what was the purpose, mention the role of the parameters used in the method. So it's always going to help others who are going to look at your code. Right. Now, in this class, I'm going to have a couple of variables more created here called int a and int b. So these are going to be called your instance variable. So what is instance variables in Java? So Java basically has two major types of variables from a class perspective. So one is called a class variable, other is called an instance variable. Instance variable means that whatever class instance you're going to create. So in this case, we are going to have OBJ and OBJ1, two instances of a class, right? So these two would be having their own copy of variables A and B. So object OBJ is going to have one value of A, one value of B. Likewise, OBJ1 is going to have some other value of A, some other value of B. But class variable, which is nothing but, you see, you could see there is a keyword here. This is called a keyword in Java, static. So you cannot use a static keywords as a name of a variable. So it's going to be a reserved keyword in Java. You cannot use it. You could use it only for its purpose, which is nothing but recognizing it as a static or a class variable. Right. So this value C, variable C, is going to be shared by all the objects which is, you know, created for this class. So OBJ and OBJ1 are going to have one value of variable C. Okay. So let's look into this main method. So main method is from where the execution is going to start. So we have created a couple of variables here and I am just going to print the value of C. So let me just comment out these three steps. So we'll go one by one. So the short form of commenting your multiple statements at one go is going to be control and use the question mark symbol. So with that, with single control, all the multiple statements can be commented. Right. So let's just run this program. So you could see it has printed the value of value C. And for both of the objects, it's going to have a same value, which is 30. That is because it's a static variable, and static variable always, the value of that is going to be common across all the objects in Java. It's not going to be having a different value for different objects. It's going to have only just one value. It's going to be stored at one particular memory location, and whichever object reference variable you want to use, it's going to access that location. Right. Next particular thing in our agenda is going to learn what is if condition. So if condition, I have created a method here called getComparison. So let me first pass on the values 40 and 30. So the short form of going into any method in Java is to use F3 button. So you just have to mention or put your mouse over onto this one and just press F3. So it's going to land you to this particular method, get comparison. Okay. So it's going to receive two variables here, int A and int B1. So what's happening within this method? Let's try to have a look. So this is how we define a syntax in Java. We are going to mention if, then mention the condition, what we wish to evaluate. If this evaluates to true, then only this block will be executed. Otherwise, it's going to go outside this block. So for the moment, let's say we don't look at this other conditions. We'll just comment it for now. And let's just run this program. So if A1 is greater than B1, it's going to go inside this block. Else, it's not going to do anything as such. So let's just say A1 is not greater than B1. For now, just keep it simple. Right? Let's execute this program. A1 is not greater than B1 is what we're going to get now. But that we are getting because we have put this as a common statement outside this if condition. So irrespective of whether it's greater or lesser, it's going to do that. So I need to put this into my else condition. So what is the else block? Else block means if your if block doesn't evaluate to true, it's going to execute the else block. So I'm going to compare values A1 and B1. So A1 is 40. 40 is greater than 30. So it's going to go inside this condition. It's going to print it. See, 40 is greater than 30. If I would have said this is 20, 20 is not greater than 30. So it will be coming within the else block. So this is how else block plays a role. If a particular set of condition doesn't hold to be true in your if block, your else block will be executed. Now there is something else called else if. What if there are multiple conditions which you would wish to evaluate, not just one condition, and if not, then you are going to else. You might have multiple conditions which you might want to check. So in that case, we can just use the else if block and mention the other condition which you wish to evaluate, which is in this case B1 greater than A1. If yes, then it was going to print this particular statement. If not, if this also doesn't hold to be true, it's going to go to this else block. So now let's run the program. So it says 30 is greater than 20. So it has gone inside our first if block. If A1 is greater than B1. Sorry, if B1 is greater than A1. So it has printed this particular statement. If 30 is greater than 20, that is B1 greater than A1, it has printed 30 is greater than 20. Now let's just make it as equal. So it's going to go finally into the else block. It says 30 is equal to 30. So this is how we are going to use our if, else if, and else statements in Java. So we have covered the first three topics here. The next topic is for loop. For loop means like, it's like an iteration. So we want to evaluate or we want to do something. So we want to iterate or we want to do some particular condition for a certain period of time. So what is the syntax of a for loop? A for loop starts with a first block is nothing but the declaration block. We are just going to declare the variable and instantiate it to some value. We could also declare the variable outside the for loop and just instantiate the value. So we could say int I, okay? And we could say I equal to 0. This is another way of using your for loop variable, but I am just simply sticking to this particular thing for now. So int I equal to 0, the middle block is going to have your condition. What is the condition you would wish to evaluate? And the last part is going to be your incrementer or decrementer. Do you want to increment the loop or you want to decrement the loop? So for now, I'm sticking it to incrementing the loop by 1. So that's the reason I++ is an operator in Java. It's going to increment your value. Once you use the value of I, after that, it is going to increment the value of I to I+1. So I've just simply put one statement here that sum plus equal to. So guys, what is the meaning of this? So when we say sum equal to sum plus A plus B, this means use the value of sum and add it to your A and B. So that is the meaning of sum equal to sum plus A plus B. So the short form of that in Java, we are saying sum plus equal to use the value of I, the iteration variable, and also this reference variables, which is A and B of the method. And after that it's done, you are going to return the value. So that's the reason now for this method, there is a return type as integer. Whereas in my previous method, it did not have any return type. So in Java, if we don't have any return type, we are going to use void. So let's now uncomment the second part and let's run this program. So it says summation of two numbers with extra value is 93. So with this iteration variable also used as a part of it, it's showing 93. So 0, 1, 2. So 2 is additional. If I would have not printed I for my addition purpose, it's going to use 2. So it's just going to print value as 90. So it has printed 3 lesser. All right. Now let's just use another variable now. So if we are going to need two-dimensional for loop, then we need to have this second condition also present. So two-dimensional for loop would be required when you are interacting with, let's say, for example, Excel. You want to get some value from Excel, or there is a array, a two-dimensional array, and you want to access the value. So in those situations, you might be requiring to use a two-dimensional array, a two-dimensional for loop, sorry. So here we are going to just add the value of variable j to this sum variable and print the value. So see, it has printed the value as 183. It has also used the value of variable j. So j, as a next example, I've taken that it is starting with minus 1. It is going to increment by 1 each time it goes inside this iteration. And it is going to go on till j is less than 1. So first time it will be minus 1. It will go inside. It will make it to 0. 0 is less than 1. Again, it will evaluate and it will print this particular. It will just go into evaluate this and it's going to have some value again added for sum. Next time it's going to make 1 incremented by 1 more, it becomes 2. It becomes 1 here. So 1, 0 plus 1 becomes 1. So it doesn't go inside this particular condition. So we will come outside and we'll return the value of sum. So let's just run this program. So it has given the value 183. Now we've seen what is a for loop, and we've seen a two-dimensional for loop also. Now let's look into the next aspect of this particular session, which is while loop. So while loop in Java, so we'll just comment out this for the time being. So while loop in Java starts with this syntax. While, mention the condition. And till this condition evaluates to true, you can do some execution. A is greater than 0. Right? You mention this condition, print the statement, and we let's execute this particular program. But before that, we wish to store the value of val with whatever value is there with a. And see, while a is greater than 0, we are just storing the value of a in val. Let's just put one more decremental logic here. So it's going to decrement the value of a after every iteration is done, and let's see what's the output. So we'll just uncomment the statement, and the value of variable passed here for a is 3. So it's good to say 3 is greater than 0, 2 is greater than 0, 1 is greater than 0. And finally, value of variable val is 1 when it is coming outside the method. That is because we have mentioned the value of val here, not after a minus minus. If you would have mentioned value of val here, it's going to return 0, because by that time already a is decremented by 1 from 1. So it's going to become 0. So see, val is 0 here. So this is the concept of while loop. Now let's just comment out this part for now. And let's execute do while. So what is a do while now? Do while means it's going to execute your while loop at least once. It says while a greater than 0, but it says do this. Then it says, okay, check this condition. So it's going to execute this loop at least once. So let's just have a value minus 1. So minus 1 is not greater than 0. So we might have not expected it to go inside, but since it's a do while, it's going to go into this particular thing at least once, and then it's going to compare this condition. Is minus 1 greater than 0? If yes, do something, otherwise come outside. Okay, so now in val, we are going to have value minus 1. It's going to say, so let's say this one as a plus plus. So minus 1 plus 1 will become 0, and then it's not going to go again inside this. So let's run this program. So we could see here that value of val in while is minus 1. So we could just say instead of while, this is do while now. So value of while in do while is minus 1. So we have seen that in do while, at least once it goes inside the loop, even if the condition doesn't hold true for the first time, then it was reaching this block. But after the condition is evaluated to be true or false, depending on that, it goes and decides whether to go inside the loop again or not. So in this case, it did not go inside. So we have seen do while as well. Now the next one is switch statement. So switch statement basically is used in those situations where you would wish to see what to do in some situation. Like if, let's just have a method called check type, and let's call it as a type. So in switch statement, based on a particular value of your parameter or something, we would want to execute some other cases or some other particular condition. So we will say switch type. So this is how the syntax of switch goes. You have to use switch keyword here. And after you have used switch keyword, you are mentioning what, on what basis you want to switch to what case. So I'm going to use keyword case here. And since this is going to be a string, I'm going to say A. Okay. So if this particular value evaluates to, or this matches to A, I'm going to do something within here. So let's say A is right and print type. So as simple. And then we'll have to put a break statement. So there is a reason we put a break statement here. The reason is because if there are, let's say, multiple cases like this, right, then we don't want it to go inside another case because it has already found the match in this case A. If this type was having a value A, then we simply just want to come outside the switch statement. We don't want it to execute and take more time. So we'll similarly put some other statements in the other case. Or we could just say inside A case. Inside B case, and just we can get the value of type. Now there is also going to be one more case called default case. The reason for the default case is that if your value does not match to any of the cases mentioned here, then you would want to execute the default. So we'll say default case. That's it. Okay, so now let's just run this program. But before that, we have to call this method. And we don't want to just do println here because already we are doing the same in this method. So we would know what's happening. We just have to call this method. So you would just call check type, and we are going to pass a value now. Let's say C. So C does not match to any case, so it has to come to default. So it has come to default case. Let's just pass a value B now. So it's going to go inside B case. If I say small b, then what does happen? The reason it went into default case is because Java is a case sensitive language. So whatever value you are mentioning here and whatever case you're going to put here, it's going to be case sensitive. So only if you have mentioned that, okay, we don't want to worry about the case. If in string variables you're using ignore case, then in that situation, it will not verify the case. But otherwise, Java is strongly a case sensitive language. Okay, so we have seen switch statement now, but it's not all about it. If in case, let's say we did not had the break condition, then what happens? So let's not have break anywhere. Okay, and let's run this program. See, it has come to default case. But let's say if I want to go and try to do this particular case only, case A, I have not used break so far. I'm, let's say, executing a break in default. The reason it has gone inside B case as well, and even the default case for that matter, is because we have not used the break statement. So even though it found the case and it has done what it had to do, it has gone to check the other cases and it has executed them because there was no break inside case A. So that's why break is so important for any case. For your performance to be minimal, you have to use break statement. Now it has gone only inside the case A. So that was all about switch statement. Now we'll see the next two concepts in one method, which is continue and break. Okay, so let's just understand what is continue and break. So let's say we have a for loop in I equal to 0, I less than 2, I plus plus, simple for loop. Okay, so now let's just check for a condition. What is the value of A and what is the value of I? So we are saying if A equals to I, so when we say equal to, we have to use double equal to. Okay, when A is equal to I, in that situation, we just want to continue. We don't want to do anything else which is after that. So after that, let's say we had a program, we had a new line. We don't want this particular statement to execute. If it is equal to I, then it's just going to say continue. Means when this particular situation happens, don't execute the other statement which follows after this. You just have to continue further. That's what this particular continues label states. Okay. So what we are going to do, we will just run this program. Okay, yeah. So we have to call this method. So use object. Let's give the value as 1. So in the first time, 1 is passed here. So 0 is not going to be equal to 1. But again, I is going to be incremented by 1. So first time, it is going to print the value of A as 1. After that, when this condition doesn't hold to be true, it's not going to print that statement. So let's run this program. So first time when we came into this method, it has printed A1. Next time when 1 and 1 were matching, it did not execute the statement. So it has printed this only once. So that's the effect of continue. Now, the other statement which we would just like to cover in this tutorial, the last one, is break. So break is basically that if a particular condition is evaluated, you just break the loop. You don't do anything further. So for that, we have to use the label break. Okay, now let's just run this program. So it has executed this, and let's just put it before. Okay, and yeah, so we have done this thing. So once the break is used, it's just going to come outside the loop. So I'll just put a condition here. So if A equal to I, we are saying it is breaking. It will break the loop and it will come outside. Okay. So let's run this method. So it has come inside this. It saw that, okay, A is equal to 1. So it has just broken the loop and it is not going to go any further. So it is not going to do anything else apart from that. So that's all about the Java concepts in this session. So we have seen these all different concepts. So hope you like this session. So we will be covering the other different concepts in Java in the next session. So do share these videos and, you know, share with your friends and hit the like and subscribe button if you like it. And if you would want me to add a few more videos on Java and Selenium. Thank you for watching. Thank you all.